Welcome, everyone. Good evening or good day. On behalf of the Atlantic Fellows for Equity in Brain Health of the Global Brain Health Institute, I am delighted to welcome you to the closing session of this wonderful satellite symposium of the Alzheimer's Association International Conference. And I hope you have enjoyed the conference just as much as I did. But despite the exciting research and great discussions, I can also tell you that we, the current cohort of Atlantic Fellows Faculty in Brain Health, feel a little sad today. Sad because we cannot meet in person in Athens. In fact, most of us fellows never had a chance yet to meet personally due to the COVID-19 pandemic. Would it not be wonderful if after a full day of listening to interesting presentations, meeting old and new colleagues from around the world, you would have a chance to reflect on the day, on our work, and just enjoy each other's company together at a table in a nice Greek restaurant in the beautiful city of Athens? Well, we are not able to do so today, but we appreciate that we are able to connect and exchange virtually through modern technology. And we would like to express our big gratitude to everyone at GBHI and AIC for making this possible. Importantly, there is a much bigger connection between us, beyond meeting personally or virtually, as we as GBHI also connect through a set of shared values. Values that unite us and bring us together, despite being in so remote and diverse locations scattered all around our beautiful world. Values that drive our work towards reducing the impact and scale of dementia, and especially towards reducing inequities in brain health globally. By practicing authenticity, fairness, openness, respect, courage, and empathy, we are truly a force. So we thought, why not have a conference dinner virtually? Why not reflect on our work and our shared values around a virtual table? Well, I now invite all of you behind your screens to make yourself comfortable, relax, maybe even grab a drink and watch a very special theatrical play featuring a 7-course menu of conversations between Atlantic Fellows for Equity in Brain Health that are certainly not science fiction. Enjoy at the table.
How have you been doing?
Well, I've been doing great. I mean, considering the pandemic, how about yourself?
Yeah, I think I've been doing all right. I would really like to discuss Mrs. D's son with you, remember?
Yes, yeah. You mean our mutual patient with dementia? How about her son?
Her son, actually, he approached me after one of his mom's clinic visits. You know, we have every once in a while. And he mentioned that he's noticing some subtle memory changes. He's a 46-year-old, right-handed, white male. He works as a lecturer in a community college. He states that it takes him longer to write the lecture notes these days. He's also having some difficulties remembering conversations with his girlfriend and the recent shared experiences.
That's pretty unusual for a 46-year-old. Strike me as a young onset dementia. And then he's probably the caregiver for his mom?
Yeah, he is. He's the caregiver, and the caregiver burden is real. I know it because he mentions it every time I see him. He mentioned he's a little bit depressed as well. But considering his strong family history for cognitive disorders, I sent him for neuropsych testing and also imaging. And it turns out that he has mild cognitive impairment. The imaging report revealed a marked degeneration of the frontal and also temporal lobes of his brain. We don't have genetic testing results yet, but his insurance won't cover any further imaging. I'm not sure if any further testing is necessary anyway.
Yeah, I agree with you. In the absence of disease-modifying therapy, it's actually difficult to justify, you know, diagnostic testing like amyloid PET with the insurance. But however, there's, you know, some development in blood biomarkers. Hopefully we get that in the next future, nearest future. Yeah.
Yeah. Actually, my struggle is whether to share the diagnosis of MCI with him or hold off for now. Bring him back maybe in a year or a year and a half, get some additional testing to see if there are any changes. I feel sharing the MCI diagnosis now would just leave him frustrated and exacerbate his depression. And I remember you had a similar case in the past. How did you manage that?
Well, you know, it was a pretty difficult case as well. And we decided it was unethical not to share the result with the patient. The news of an early onset dementia actually crushed her in that case. However, she was very happy that we were clear and authentic with her. I think that that is about the best strategy in these circumstances. I'm sure you're aware, but just remember to offer support right away. I'll give him phone numbers and options for social and spiritual support if he wants it.
You think I should give him all the information right away? I mean, won't it just be overwhelming too much?
Yeah, I mean, you're right. But from my experience, this news could lead to some pretty extreme measures. You know, I've even heard of suicidal attempts after a dementia diagnosis, a conversation with physicians. It's very important that he feels he has someone to run to in case he feels he needs help.
That is going to be a hard conversation for me to initiate. I mean, yeah, but I agree with you. Authenticity is the best strategy here. Thank you for helping me get my thoughts together.
Thank you for, you know, confiding in me.
Hey, how are you feeling after today?
After today, I really can't stop thinking about the family. I mean, so much of today's sessions were focused on the diagnosis, the details, all of the little minute pieces around the various diseases. But what we're really talking about here is a huge life event, and it affects so many people around that person receiving the diagnosis. Honestly, where's the humanity today?
Yeah. Why not?
Yes, please. Thank you. Cheers.
Cheers. Yeah, you know, I think the increased awareness around dementia is changing the way that we deal with diagnosis. It used to be something that was kept really private, like within the family, but now there's a lot more openness around these conversations, which is so important. You know, 78% of people are worried about developing dementia at some stage in their lives, which is just such a high statistic. And so having these open conversations is just so, so important.
Completely. I mean, it's so wonderful that the media, in a sense, is sharing more of these stories around dementia and is bringing more awareness to the disease, I think, because of that. But oftentimes the portrayal in the different stories, they're so stereotypical. And I can't help but think that they oftentimes create maybe even more fear around the diagnosis, since they focus so heavily on that kind of sharp, rapid decline. I mean, even that word, dementia, from the get-go.
I know. As someone working in the field, it's a word we struggle with a lot because of those negative connotations, right? But at the same time, as a researcher, as a scientist, I have to call it something. So it's just, it's so complex. But I can understand if you're somebody who's maybe less familiar with terminology like neurodegenerative diseases and labels like dementia, you know, it must be really hard to try to navigate all of this information.
Totally. I mean, that's a big one, neurodegenerative diseases in and of itself, like how all-encompassing. And I think that that's why there's maybe so much fear and stigma around the diagnosis, because it's so complex.
Yeah. I do think that more younger people are talking to like their doctor and their friends kind of about their worries and about brain health, which in itself is kind of a newer phrase or newer terminology that we wouldn't have had, you know, even a few years ago.
Completely. But I mean, with that, we can't forget what has happened with past diagnoses. I mean, it still has a huge impact on families and spouses that are still alive today. I mean, my grandma, my grandfather, he died of Alzheimer's, and she has put off seeing a doctor, even though she has been complaining over the past several years of increased memory concerns. But she's really traumatized around the diagnosis and around what it meant to go through that even decades ago.
So much emphasis on genetics, on family history, when we know now that there's so many other factors that contribute to somebody's risk of developing dementia, you know, and especially lifestyle factors like healthy diet and exercise, socially engaging with people, staying calm.
I can't forget that.
Fine.
So whenever there's a diagnosis in the family though, especially when a child speaks up, or not, I mean, I think that they're probably thinking it. You know, what happens if I'm next? What does that look like? And then of course, it's compounded by the fact that their loved one just received this life-changing diagnosis. And we can't ignore all of that, all those different perspectives.
Yeah. I know for some people that in the moment, that diagnosis can be a relief in some ways. Because people are living it, right? They know there's something going on, the person oftentimes and the family as well. So to have a name to put on this thing that they've been experiencing and living can be in some ways a relief. But then as the relief settles in, you know, it starts to get complicated again.
Totally. I mean, what happens next? What are we going to do when it gets worse? I think that running list of questions that spin through everyone's mind probably just gets more and more complicated, partially because there is a lack of resolve, as there aren't any clear answers. And I think that everyone's experience is so different. And of course, there are similarities, but there's such vast differences between the way that individuals experience this, that it's challenging for the family or even for the physician to help the family create any sort of plan.
Yeah. And, you know, these plans often are so focused on all the things that the person maybe loses or that change, but there's so much that people can still do. And we don't talk about that enough. You know, we need to focus more on kind of the positive aspects, the things that people can still do.
Completely. I mean, it's going to be a very different life, but it can still be a good one.
Yeah. Cheers to that.
Cheers to that.
Sabe, Milton, quando a gente conversa sobre a justiça, tem muitas coisas que acontecem no Brasil que faz a gente pensar sobre isso, né? Os níveis, os números de casos de demência estão aumentando cada vez mais aqui no Brasil, assim como na América Latina, de uma forma geral. E principalmente por alguns fatores de risco que não são bem controlados. Por exemplo, nós ainda temos níveis de educação muito baixos, o tratamento de obesidade, de hipertensão, de diabetes, é muito mal conduzido ainda. Então, esses são problemas que atrapalham bastante a população de uma forma geral, né?
Sí, gracias, Berenice. Realmente es bueno analizar la situación de salud en América Latina, especialmente las demencias. Creo yo que, por ejemplo, en Nicaragua es muy importante que hay mucha diferencia en el acceso a los servicios de salud mental y de atención a las demencias tanto en el área urbana como rural. Y realmente algo que me preocupa a mí es que en Nicaragua las zonas rurales no tienen un acceso adecuado para el diagnóstico, para el tratamiento, incluso para hacer estudios de neuroimagen. Es muy difícil encontrar, por ejemplo, especialistas en zonas rurales que puedan brindar un diagnóstico acertado sobre los problemas de demencia.
Sim. Sabe que no Brasil existem muitas diferenças também entre a assistência prestada no sistema público e no sistema privado, né? Por exemplo, no sistema público, as pessoas vão ser atendidas por um médico generalista que, se achar necessário, vai encaminhar para um especialista, um neurologista, um psiquiatra, um geriatra. Isso pode levar muitos meses para acontecer, né? A não ser que a pessoa tenha sorte de morar num grande centro e estar vinculada a um centro universitário. Daí, ela sim, ela consegue fazer isso de uma forma muito mais rápida. Mas, se não for assim, vai ter que esperar bastante tempo. E, além disso, toda a equipe de saúde, de uma forma geral, é muito centralizada também nos grandes centros. Por exemplo, se a pessoa precisa de um especialista, esse especialista encaminha para um centro de reabilitação que tenha neuropsicólogo, terapeuta ocupacional, fisioterapeuta. Toda essa equipe também se concentra nos grandes centros. Então, o sistema privado está mais centralizado e o acesso a esse tratamento multiprofissional também é bastante centralizado.
Sim, é muito interessante porque algo assim também sucede em Nicaragua, mas também, Berenice, quando as pessoas padecem de demência, por exemplo, son atendidos directamente por sus propias familias. Es decir, que aparentemente no hay unos recursos públicos para accesar adecuadamente a estos servicios, pero cuando no existen, entonces las personas tienen que asumir la carga de cuidar a las personas con demencia o con cualquier otro tipo de enfermedad. Esto realmente es una situación bastante compleja, difícil, porque en las zonas rurales se acentúa aún más. En algunas zonas urbanas también pueden haber algunas diferencias, sobre todo en regiones donde, o en zonas donde hay alta riqueza y alta pobreza, también hay diferencias en la atención y los servicios de atención a la salud y a las demencias.
Sí. Pois é, um país tão extenso como o nosso, né, as diferenças socioeconômicas são muito, muito grandes. Pelo menos uma vantagem do sistema público no Brasil é que o acesso à medicação é gratuito para todas as pessoas. Então, isso é uma diferença para outros países, né? Mas, como tu falaste, no Brasil também o acesso e o cuidado são muito centralizados na família. E isso acaba não sendo justo para essas famílias que arcam com esse fardo todo do cuidado, né? Mas bom saber sobre essas notícias da Nicarágua.
Vamos a aprender más. Había olvidado comentarte, Berenice, que todavía las poblaciones indígenas continúan también en peor situación porque no tienen acceso prácticamente, aún en las zonas rurales, a servicios de atención integral a la salud mental y a las demencias. Las poblaciones indígenas están prácticamente olvidadas. Pero es un gusto tremendo nuestra conversación, Berenice. Y a ver, y es un gusto muy bonito conversar así contigo, alguien de Brasil.
Hey Magda, I've been dying to talk to you about your new dance project. Ever since you hosted the Dementia Inclusive Dance Party for the Forget Me Not Choir a little while ago, I've been thinking how important it is to include dance in our everyday lives.
Hey Karen, meeting you and the Forget-Me-Nots was a blast, and I love that online dance party. But before I tell you about my latest dance project, can we backtrack a little bit?
Of course, yeah. I'm really curious. What made you switch your career from the lab to the dance floor?
Well, the story goes back to when I was still working full-time in the neuropharmacology lab, and at the same time, I was running community-based adult ballet classes, as well as creative dance programs for intergenerational refugees, older adults living with Parkinson's disease and dementia.
Wow, gosh, that must have kept you busy.
For sure. So actually, the story is about one of these programs. A few weeks after running one of these classes, I ran into one of the participants in the grocery store. She was super excited to see me. But she said, you know, my husband has Alzheimer's disease, and we haven't really had a lot of conversations lately. But after your class, he became really animated. And that evening, we had the first conversation we've had in months. And that was so profound for her, but it had a huge impact on me. So much so that I made a huge shift in my career and have since dedicated myself entirely to supporting building creative community for older adults and people living with dementia.
Wow, that's a really powerful story, Magda. You know, and I'm sure it took a lot of courage for that dancer to share the story about her husband so openly in a grocery store. Wow. I've had similar experiences hosting intergenerational reminiscence workshops. So in a workshop, we would use props like a Sony Walkman or travel alarm clocks or glass milk bottles or anything at all, household items, to start a conversation. It's amazing to hear the stories that are sparked from everyday items.
Oh, you know, I had a Sony Walkman when I was younger. You're bringing me back, Karen.
Yeah, well, that's the point, Magda. We had this amazing conversation. There was this gentleman who was living with dementia, and he was talking about a mixtape. He had made a mixtape for his wife, well, his future wife. And what he would do, he told me the story that he would put the cassette tape beside the radio and wait for a favorite song to come on. And then he'd just press record for all her favorite songs. That story made it into a play.
Oh, what's beautiful. Thank you for sharing that. So how does a reminiscence workshop turn into a reminiscence play?
Well, I suppose it might be a little bit like your dance classes. We get consent forms from everybody to record conversations. And then I listen back to the bits that cause the most animation, the bits that were exciting for everybody. And then when I script it and I have act one done, we go back to the workshop again. And then the participants read out the parts. And then when we get to the part where somebody says, yep, that's my bit, that's how I know I've struck gold. That's how we co-create a play.
I love it, Karen. It sounds like your reminiscence work and my dance work are very interconnected. You just reminded me actually of a comment that friends from one of the participants of a dance class I'm currently teaching at the Dementia Action Alliance shared with me. So one of these participants has been having a really, really tough year. And they reflected to me that since she's joined my classes, they're really seeing her blossom.
Oh, that's a lovely comment. So listen, Magda, back to your dance project. What's the goal?
So the main goal is to create a safe space for each person in the class to support their individual discovery and in their own unique abilities. It takes a lot of courage to step into a creative space and try something new. But the outcome is really profound. And the class supports a flexibility and sensitivity between being in the self and being with the other, the group. And that is really pivotal for building mutually beneficial communities. And I see my role as a catalyst of these dementia-inclusive creative communities, but then stepping back and allowing them to grow and develop.
Wow. You know, that sounds just like the forget-me-nots. Do you know, will we show the rest of the people around the table the clip of the dance party that you hosted? Wouldn't that be a bit of fun?
Oh, sure, that would be great. Let's do it.
Oh, thanks so much for sharing that, Magda. I suppose, you know, the mood you created in the room that day was just fantastic. And I suppose it reminds me of the work that Grainne's doing through music, and Nicky's doing it through theatre, and I suppose Mollie's doing it through Pilates as well.
Yes, it's really important to include the arts in all stages of planning for dementia care or any care. And you know, it takes courage to make sure that the arts are represented. They're so often overlooked, but we just have to keep on banging that drum.
Absolutely. So Magda, give us three good reasons to include the arts.
Okay, here's one. Creative engagement. It validates individuals and groups and offers a forum for voice and expression.
Okay, good. I can think of another one. It promotes and supports brain health, physical health, and mental health.
The third, it's a fun activity and enjoyment is the goal and it's a human right.
Brilliant, Magda. Enjoyment, that's the goal, isn't it? And that's good enough for me.
Here's the thing.
Yeah, it's a human right. Cheers to that.
Wow, Karen, Magda, that is so interesting. You know, it's amazing to see what a positive impact these activities have on people's lives. You know, if you ask people living with dementia and their supporters what it is they find most valuable, it's often the community and creative activities that they're valuing the most. Okay, I mean, don't get me wrong. Medical treatments are hugely important, and we're all hoping that we're going to have disease-modifying therapies available soon. But you also need to listen to and respect the views of our patients and their families. You know, really understand what it is that they value too. So that's why I work in Person Public Voice. We call it PPV for short.
Wow, Sarah, that's so interesting. Can you explain to me more, please? What is that exactly?
Hi, Adrian. Yes, yeah, no, thanks for asking. So it's a method of involving members of the public in the design, implementation, and dissemination of research and clinical services. And what it does is empowers people to play an active role in their own health, and it also helps to democratize the research process.
But what about basic research? I mean, cure and therapies are important, but progress is going to be slow if we don't understand the underlying mechanisms that cause dementia. For example, I'm interested to analyze the mechanisms of right metabolism during aging and dementia. So what role can patients play in research like mine?
Absolutely brilliant question there, Adrian. And you're right. You know, before I moved into PPV, I was actually an electrophysiologist. So, you know, sitting there with my head in a Faraday cage most days, that work felt really niche. And this can be a bit of a problem. So with so much research being public or government funding, the public opinion holds significant sway over how those funds are allocated, and we don't want basic science to be overlooked. But although it may seem as though basic science and the lay public are a bit like oil and water, you know, it's just not the case. So I found that people from all backgrounds are interested in and they recognize the importance of well-explained basic research, especially if it's framed around those broader goals and values that they're able to connect with. So really, it's up to us as researchers to get out there and speak about what we do and how essential that is for discovery. I mean, also, don't forget that patients and the lay public can really help us here. If we speak with them about how we're communicating our work, they're going to offer us some great insights, and I don't doubt they're going to make our communications easier to understand and a lot more compelling.
Well, that's true. I didn't consider that, Sarah. For example, in my research, it's full of complicated pathways. I wonder if speaking with members of the public could help me to write simplified explanations for my work. It may even help when I'm applying for funding, especially if the reviewers don't work in my field. So where else in the research process can members of the public help out? And what about parts of the world where I am expert and their input is less relevant?
Yeah, so, I mean, I've seen examples where members of the public have added value to all parts of the research journey, you know, from priority setting partnerships through developing patient information for clinical trials to becoming co-investigators. So I guess where their value sits really depends on your project and the population you're working with. You know, it's not really that much different from bringing in any other expert to help with your work. Say you could hire a statistician to help you with some really tricky data. They wouldn't be able to tell you which primary antibody to use to stain your tissue, but you'll value their expertise when it comes to your data. Now, working with the public is really similar. They bring an expertise that you just don't have to parts of your research where that knowledge is valuable. But, you know, don't forget that it's important that you take that time to review your work and to understand where the public input is going to be beneficial. You'll need to be able to explain what you're doing so they understand what it is they're contributing to and why. But most importantly, you need to respect their knowledge and treat them as experts by experience.
Oh, yeah, I'm totally okay with the respect. But for example, how can I implement PPV in a low-income country? I mean, few researchers understand the concept, and may sound fancy, and also the majority of current guidance for conducting PPV relates to high-income settings, with no specific guidance available for developing PPV in low-income settings. However, there's a global need for quality research contextualized for low- and middle-income countries.
Oof, yeah, that's a really, really good question. So I feel really lucky here in the UK, since this is becoming part of the research landscape. And in fact, so many funders now ask that you involve members of the public before you even submit a grant application. But there's definitely more work to be done globally, measuring the understanding and appetite for PPV. In fact, here at the Global Brain Health Institute, our Person Public Voice team, well, we're looking to develop a global involvement toolkit just for this purpose. So maybe that's something you could be involved with.
Well, Sarah, that sounds interesting. It may take up you on that offer. So maybe the voice we're missing here is the voice of the patient, right? When it comes to diagnosis, with all the fear, the culture and the support, who knows more about this than the patients themselves?
Hear, hear.
Hello, everyone. Do you mind if I join you? I overheard some of your conversations, and I'd love to share my own personal story about being a carer. I hope this is okay. I was my mom's full-time carer for her latter years, and this happened far too early in life, due mainly to her own doctor not disclosing what he suspected at the time to be Alzheimer's, and he just didn't refer her on. It turned out Mom actually had vascular dementia. So as this progressed, Mom lost more and more of her independence, and I had to step in more and more with personal care, financial affairs, her legal affairs, and basically all aspects of daily life. And the thing is, people with dementia, if diagnosed early, can live very full lives. You know, with a little support, they can remain at work, continue driving, stay active, and are very valuable assets in their communities. Now, the level of care obviously changes as the disease advances. But in my opinion, there's certainly no burden. I now have the privilege of supporting Helen, who lives with younger onset Alzheimer's. And Helen just needs support when traveling or keeping her busy life in check. Helen is really active, involved in many research projects, and a very strong public patient voice. Actually, here's Helen now.
Hello, everybody. Sorry to gatecrash your party. It's nice to see you all enjoying yourselves. But I think there's something you forgot. There's somebody on your invitation list that you forgot. And that is me. It's strange you're having a conversation about me, but I'm not included. Like most Irish people, I love a good dinner party. I like to get glammed up and I love to meet new people. Of course, I'm disappointed, as I should have been involved from the planning stage of your gathering. I would have loved to join you for an aperitif. You could have got to know me as a person. And you could see that and realize that I can communicate. However, I do have short-term memory problems, but I'm exceptionally good at imaginatively filling the gaps. I'm an expert by experience, which could really help in your research work. I appreciate you have not invited me out of fear, or maybe you have not had public patient involvement training. You may wonder how I would get to the dinner, or where I would sit, or what I would like to eat. And I love my food. These are all challenges for researchers. My travel and security are important. Or maybe you had not thought about my personhood or a rights-based approach. It's important you all get confidence at inviting the Mies of this world to the table. By doing so, you are breaking down barriers. When you invite me, I want you to know I'm a full equal citizen. So by involving me in the beginning, it's a win-win for you. Because by involving me, you're empowering me. It's a non-pharmacological intervention. It has a therapeutic benefit for me. And most of all, it improves the functioning of my brain. And it gives me a sense of purpose and hope. And hope is all I have because there's no cure for my illness. As I eavesdropped, I stopped and I heard you cover many interesting points, which I was most impressed with. You discussed maybe not telling the person, which is common today. You used words like unethical, fear, brain health, labels such as dementia, and all I have is Alzheimer's. And that's enough for me, that label. You also talked about the importance of the arts, reminiscence, and something that's really important to me, enjoyment. I'm still the same Helen, and I love to enjoy my life. Please be sure to invite me to your next party. I hope you will enjoy my unique and valuable contribution to research, which will be recognized in papers and journals, etc. Please remember, patient-centered outcomes are important, and so are my human rights. Because if we do not include those things, we never grow. In finishing, I would like to quote Don Stanion. It's okay not to be perfect. It's okay to make mistakes. It's okay to do something that you hadn't done before. Because if we don't do those things, we never grow. I hope by joining your party, you've all grown and that you won't be afraid to invite me in the future. Enjoy your evening. And as we say in Ireland, sláinte. Enjoy.
Luciano, you know, it's really interesting to hear Helen and Carmel explaining so clearly why it's vital for us to put their voices at the centre of the table. Language really makes a difference. And I think that's one thing we've all learned from this dinner party. In the future, I will certainly be more careful about using the word carer when there's a difference between caring and supporting somebody living with dementia.
Yeah, Grainne, we are learning every day. In the past, we used to think that dementia was one single thing, but nowadays we know we are talking about a group of diseases like Alzheimer's disease, frontotemporal dementia, vascular dementia, Lewy body, you know. What we need to understand that each person living with dementia has different needs. So awareness is doing this, is moving us forward to a more inclusive and respectful society.
Absolutely. I think there's lots of opportunities to grow awareness and understanding through training. How clinicians can benefit from listening more to the person living with dementia. How artists can support an individual's voice in a more person-centered approach through an arts engagement. And how we all, as artists, clinicians, and researchers can help each other. Because each of us have a different angle, but in the end, it's all about the people we meet through our work.
Yeah, we should definitely do that, be more open to each other. It takes a lot of courage to change things.
And a little creativity.
Yeah, you're right. Creativity is a form of courage.
Well, creativity is another word in how we use. We're all creatives. And I hope in that my role as a senior GBHI fellow next year, I'll continue to take courage in bringing people together around other tables, maybe even a virtual one, and find ways to connect to the arts in music, song, and lived experiences.
I'm so glad to hear that, Grainne. I think that our progress needs a toast. So may I have your attention, please? I would like to thank everyone tonight for being open and authentic, respectful with each other, and above all for sharing empathy among ourselves. And also, I'd like us to raise a glass to Helen Rochford Brennan on this night of on her 71st birthday. Thank you for sharing your birthday evening with us. And as people say in Ireland, Sláinte.